Hi, this is Dr. A. In your third video on Introduction to Medical Terminology, we are going to look at the medical record in healthcare settings. Okay, so in a medical record, and this is whether this is an old paper record or an electronic medical record, you are still going to have all of these divisions and areas where you can find information. So the history and physical is written by the admitting physician and detail the patient's history, exam results, initial diagnosis, and the physician's plan of treatment. It is often followed by the physician's orders, and these are the orders that the doctor has written. Oftentimes now in electronic medical records, the doctors can enter their own orders into the system. But when we had paper records, and those were absolutely everywhere, there was, orders were written on a sheet of paper, and then the secretaries would have to decipher the orders and put them into the various computer systems. But a physician's orders is going to be a complete list of their care, therapeutic procedures, and all the things that need to be done, their medications that they need to take, the tests that have been ordered, the treatments. So all of that is going to be, you have to have a physician order for everything that you do to a patient. You can't even put oxygen on a patient without a physician's order. Okay. Next is the nurse's notes. So that is a record of the patient's care throughout the day, because the nurses are the ones that are doing the one-on-one care for that patient. It can include the vital signs, some treatment specifics, the patient's response to treatment, and the patient's condition. The physician's progress notes then is a daily record of the patient's condition. They're the results of the physician checking in on the patient and doing either a physical exam, looking at a summary of the test results that had been done, updated assessment, maybe an updated diagnosis depending on the results of different tests, maybe some further plans for treatment as, the care progresses for that patient. Next, we have consultation reports. So those are going to be written and given by a specialist, a doctor that has been consulting when the physician asks for a patient evaluation. So for example, a general practitioner could ask for a cardiology consult if their patient is having some heart issues, okay? The ancillary reports will have the results from various treatments and therapies. Those are gonna be like rehab services, so like physical therapy, occupational therapy. They can be from social services visiting, they can be from respiratory therapy or dietetics. So that's where you will find the notes that these professionals have entered on your patient. The operative reports are going to be from the surgeon detailing the operation. If there's not been an operation, there will not be an operative report, right? It will include pre and post operative diagnosis and specific details of the procedure and how the patient tolerated the procedure. And along with that, then you will also have an anesthesiologist's report, and it relates to the details of the drugs that were given to the patient during surgery and their response to anesthesia and the vital signs during surgery. So those kind of, they're separate, but they go together, right? And then we have the diagnostic reports. So those are the result of all diagnostic tests performed on the patients, from lab all the way to medical imaging. Anything that's done in the realm of diagnosis, testing, those reports will be there. Then the pathologist report is a report that's given by a pathologist who studies a tissue that was removed from the patient. So if there was a biopsy, or if a limb was amputated or something was removed from the patient and then it was sent for analysis, then the pathologist would write up the report, and then it might fall under the diagnostic report and then just be a separate tab there for pathology. Next, we have informed consent. So this documents voluntarily signed by the patient order responsible party, and it's usually agreeing to treatment or agreeing to a certain procedure, and it clearly describes the purpose of the procedure, the methods, the procedures itself, the benefits and risks of the procedures. So you definitely want informed consent if you're going to have surgery, but you want informed consent just to even be seen by a physician, to be seen in an urgent care, to be seen in an OR, or I'm sorry, in an ER. You would have to sign an informed consent to receive a blood transfusion, for example. And then discharge summary, it outlines the patient's entire hospital stay. So this is once the stay has been completed. And so it will include their condition at admission, their admitting diagnosis, all the test results, treatments, the patient's response to treatments, the final diagnosis, and all the follow-up plans. All right, next let's look at the healthcare settings. So you can have acute care or general hospitals. They provide services to diagnose and treat disease for a short period of time. And generally they have an emergency room that you can visit for emergent care. You have specialty care hospitals. So they can provide care for a specific type of disease. So for example, a psychiatric hospital. But we also have some really good and renowned cancer hospitals, like, for example, MD Anderson in Houston. That would be an example. Nursing home or a long-term care facility. They provide long-term care for patients who need extra time to recover before going home or for persons who cannot care for themselves. So it is okay to have a short stint or short stay in a nursing home for a few weeks to just kind of have bridge between the acute care or general hospital stay and being back at home. But sometimes people can't realistically go back home. And so unless they have somebody that lives with them and can care for them, a lot of times a nursing home or a long-term care facility is where they may end up, especially towards the end of life. Ambulatory care, surgical center, or outpatient clinic. So those are kind of all interchangeable in a way. So they're all for patients who do not need overnight care. These centers can do simple surgeries. They offer therapies or diagnostic testing. So you could go to an outpatient clinic for a CT. Or an MRI, or you could go for physical therapy, or you could go for a simple surgery that does not require an overnight stay. So those are all, kind of similar in a lot of ways. Next, you have the physician's office. It can be an individual's office or a group of doctors. It is really more and more a group of doctors because it is really hard for a physician to run an office by themselves. It's costly. It's better to group with other physicians. These physicians will provide diagnostic and treatment services in an office setting. So this is where you get your primary care, where you get your checkups, your annual checkups, or if you're being followed for chronic conditions, you get your checkup visits. If you need diabetes care or something like that. Then we have HMOs, or health maintenance organizations. So there are a group of primary care physicians, specialists, and other healthcare professionals, and they're often even a group with hospitals and stuff, and they provide a wide range of services in a prepaid system. So that's the idea of an HMO, is everything has been is prepaid, and you pay into the system, into the HMO, and then you can receive care, but you can only receive care from the HMO that you pay into. Next, we have home health care. So those are agencies that provide nursing, therapy, personal care, or housekeeping services in a patient's home. So they can come in and do physical therapy, or they can come in and for nursing, they can come in and give certain medications, infuse an IV medication. They can help the patient care for themselves, get a shower, housekeeping, you know, they may even cook for them, etc. So all of this happens in the patient's home, and this is in hopes to keep them out of a nursing home or long-term care facility and keep them at home. Rehabilitation services or a rehab hospital or a rehab facility provides physical and occupational therapy. They can provide it on an inpatient or outpatient basis. It can be a place where a patient can transition from acute care hospital, they can transition to a rehabilitation facility before they go home. But sometimes they may have to go to a nursing home. So it just depends on the situation. And then lastly, we have hospice care. And this is an organized group of health workers that provide supportive treatment to terminally ill patients and their families. So generally to qualify for hospice care, you have to be kind of in the last 6 months of life. So you have a terminal diagnosis with a set amount of time left. It's, of course, impossible to completely predict exactly how long a person has left. So that's, you know, somewhere usually around 6 months. They help provide care, pain medications, pain management, whatever is needed. But we're not trying to treat or cure the condition anymore. We're just trying to manage the symptoms and manage the pain or manage it as and make the patient as comfortable as possible until they pass. Hospice can be given at home. So some of the home health agencies can also do hospice care at home if the patient chooses that, or there are hospice care facilities where a patient would go and it would stay there until they passed. And so it's an excellent end of life service because these professionals know how to deal with all the questions and all the things that come up with end-of-life care. All right, so that wraps up our healthcare settings and our medical records.